تبارك الله رب العالمين.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله الذي جعل ذكره طمأنينة للقلوب وجلاء لها عن رين الذنوب ومطردة لوسواس الخناس المكذوب. والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد الداعي إلى كل فعل محبوب وأمر مطلوب، وعلى آله وأصحابه المقتفين سبيله على خير أسلوب. أما بعد، فيقول رب تبارك وتعالى في كتابه المنزل: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. لن تنالوا البر حتى تنفقوا مما تحبون، وما تنفقوا من شيء فإن الله به عليم. صدق الله العظيم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that you will not reach righteousness until you spend out of that which you love. And whatever you spend in the path of Allah, whatever you spend for Allah, Allah is most knowing of it. Continuing from where we ended last week, which was a reflection on the immense dedication and pain that parents endured in bringing you into the world. And we did this while reflecting on the prayer we're asked to make in the Quran: Allahumma arhamhuma kama rabbayani saghira. Oh Allah, shower them with mercy, care for them, show them compassion as they did in my infancy to me, as they treated me with compassion and dedication in my infancy. Now today I want to focus more on that reversal of roles, because we spoke about the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using the word Rabb and Rabba, which means to cherish, which means to sustain, which is what the parent does, kama rabbayani. And then it appears that there's a reversal of the positions of the letters in this word to call our attention to become barr. Barra, which means to become bar. And in that reversal, there is a reversal of roles. But it is not a reversal of you becoming the parent, because there is an added letter in the word Rabb for Rabb al-Ab al-Ibna. When a parent is caring for a child, there is extension. And there's a rule in Arabic that al-ziyadatu fil bina tadulla ala ziyadatu fil ma'na. And so the word is Rababa, and then it has an extra, a weak letter is added to the end. And that shows that there's something more. It's not just the reversal, but there's more to be added to it. Because it is a reversal of roles of kindness that the mother and father deserves from children. We're living today at a time when respect and kindness and sacrifice for parents are seen as disruptive to having a good life. People say, I need to take care of myself, and so I cannot deal with the problems of my parents. And that itself is a problem. They say, I have my own problems. And as a result of this thinking, there are large numbers of parents living in their old age and later years in isolation. Yes, living in isolation and dying alone. In the UK alone, loneliness is a big problem. There are nearly 4 million old people living alone, and half of those believe that they feel ignored. They feel that they're being ignored, and some they say that we have become invisible. Now, how did we arrive at this situation? Well, in previous times, this would not be the case. There is a culture of disassociation from parents and such that starts at a very young age. In the push for independence, push for individuality, and heavy focus on individualism, through the teachings of Freud and others, that we become so self-centered that we forget that we owe a debt to our parents. This debt that I explained last week and the week before that, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us dependent on our parents. We're not like the other, like the animals, like the cows and the cattle that stand. After they are born, 4 hours after they are born, they stand up and start to feed themselves. Human beings, when they are born, they are utterly dependent on their parents for years. And Allah has made it so. He could have made it the other way around, but He has made it so that you will feel, you will recognize that you are functioning in the mercy of Allah. You have survived in the mercy that Allah has placed in the heart of your parents, such that the parents' heart becomes completely dedicated to you. That, and I keep saying this example, that if there is one seat on a lifeboat and you are with your parents will always say, "Save my child." Because the life of the child is more valuable than the life of the parent. They see the life of the child more valuable. So in the Quran, we talked about these two words, these Rabb al-Walad, Rabb al-Qawm, Rabb al-Ma'dan. That Rabb, when it's used in this context of ore, you take a stone out and turn it into a diamond. That is what they do. They're working hard on the child. Rabb al-Ma'dan aslahahu. And so we have Rabb al-Muhajirin, Rabb al-Qawm, Ra'asahum, Rabb al-Tijara, Nammahu. All of these are developing, taking things and transforming them, bringing them to their full potential. That is all what Rabb means. And interestingly enough, both of these words, Rabb and Barr, are linked. They have a linkage to names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-Rabbu tabaraka wa ta'ala. Allah is the sustainer. Ar-Rabb. Ultimately, Allah is Rabb. And then one of Allah's beautiful names, Asma'ullah al-Husna, is also Al-Barr. For both words, we have the same. We have a link to the name of Allah. Al-Barr, which means the source of goodness and kindness. The one who is most kind and gracious and good in all good that is bestowed on human beings comes from Allah. So He is ultimately Al-Barr. And we are asked to be Barram biwalidain, Birr. And then another meaning of the word Barr is righteousness, Birr. Birr, they say that is kalimatun jami'atun. It is a comprehensive name, comprehensive word for all good deeds. So when you want to know about good in the world, when you want to know about how to be good in the world, which is the being Muslim, if you want to be a good Muslim, if you want that the way to describe that, one of the ways of describing that righteousness is birr. Comes from the same word what we use for obedience and kindness to parents, which is birrul walidain. And that is the first point of your experience with the need for birr. The need for righteousness is in your first relationship, and your first relationship is with your parents. Now, to understand how the Sahaba felt with this, how did they internalize this? What was their understanding of birrul walidain? And in the context of mother, of course, we need to reflect on the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who said that when he was asked, a person came to him and asked, you know, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, سَأَلْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ أَيُّ الْأَعْمَالِ أَفْضَلُ. I asked him that what is, of all the good deeds, which is the best one? What are the best of good deeds that I can do? And of course, the purpose here is to be successful in the world and be successful in the next. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, الصَّلَاةُ عَلَىٰ وَقْتِهَا. The first is praying 5 daily prayers on time. Not to leave it until the sun sets and procrastinate. Praying 5 daily, that's the best. If you want to perfect your deen, if you want to be successful in this world and the next, that's the first thing. And the second thing he says, ثُمَّ قُلْتُ أَيُّ. And then he said, بِرُّ الْوَالِدَيْنِ. The next after that is kindness to parents, not hurting the parent, not speaking to them in harsh tones, showing kindness to parents. And I gave you examples last week. And I'm going to urge you all to go over and listen to this series of lectures. We are now today on our 10th lecture, and we will pass out the leaflet. Please go home and listen to them with your children. Make sure you all have the entire series in your mind. Go over them. Because these things are needed in today's world. We are having there's a crisis, there's a global crisis of parent-child relationship. Even up to the United Nations, people are talking about a global surge in juvenile delinquency. There is a problem, and that problem is rooted in this disconnect between parent and child. And a lot of it has to do with the training in psychology, where things are rooted in the teachings of Freud. So much so that people blame parents for all psychological illness. One person came to me and said that now I understand why I suffer from depression. And I said, how do you know that? And he said, well, yeah, I went to a therapist and she walked me through all the points where my parents did something that might have hurt me when I was a child. And it's because of that has happened. And now I feel better because I now understand. When in fact, by blaming your parents, you're incurring. He didn't feel better. He suffered later on. And the global study that's now proven in 72 countries, they conducted a study, a meta-study, 32,000 people, and they found that people who spend their time blaming parents for difficulties in their life are more prone to mental illness. This is the conclusion of it. Because if you decide to blame your parents, anyway, we'll come to that. What I want to do is to explain to you what the Sahaba, how did they feel? What did they think about it? So, Wabisah radiallahu anhu came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and before he could ask the question, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, جِئْتَ تَسْأَلَ عَنِ الْبِرْ. You came to ask what is birr. You want to know what is righteousness? And he said, yes, I did. I want to know what is birr. فَقَالَ الْبِرُّ مَطْمَأَنَّتْ إِلَيْهِ نَفْسٌ وَطْمَأَنَّتْ إِلَيْهِ النَّفْسُ وَطْمَأَنَّ إِلَيْهِ الْقَلْبُ وَالْإِثْمُ مَا حَاكَ فِي صَدْرِكَ فِي نَفْسِكَ وَتَرَدَّدَ فِي الصَّدْرِ وَإِنْ أَفْتَاكَ النَّاسُ وَأَفْتُوكَ. He said that birr is that thing that settles, that where your heart settles upon it and you are content. You feel the internal warmth of consistency in your heart and your rest of you and your life. Your entire life fits together because you're kind to birr in the first instance. And birr in the first instance, righteousness in the first point is with parents. If you fail at the first hurdle, then you will fall at all the others. You cannot expect to be nice to society and horrible to your parents and be successful. It doesn't work like that. Because what happens is, and he explains the opposite. He says that al-birr, that ithm, the opposite to birr, sin is mahaka fi sadrik, the thing that sticks you in the heart, and taraddada fi sara, and is constantly, it creates a discontent, a dissatisfaction with life, a disturbance in your joys. And oh, if you have all the riches in the world, it doesn't matter. There is gloom in the horizon, and you see misery, sadness and pain and unhappiness. There's an irritation and an uneasiness in the heart because you've disconnected from your primary place where you're supposed to demonstrate, you're supposed to be grateful for the debt that your parents, the debt that you owe your parents, of their care that they spent on you. So what happens in this situation? When you're feeling this, then Shaitan comes and tells you, oh, you have to deal with this by cultivating a list of grievances against the parents. And you sit down and think, oh, well, my parents did this to me, this is why this is happening. And my parents did that to me, and this is why this is happening. And in most cases, it is imagined or misconstrued, the motivation of the parents. The parents are usually trying to protect you, and you are misconstruing it. And then you're asked, you know, our young people today are watching people on the internet. YouTube is being the new guide. Jordan Peterson, he most famous psychologist in the world today, he says that you must sit down and write all your grievances against your parents. That's his advice. That you must write all your grievances against your parents. Sit down and make a list, and that will relieve you. In fact, if you follow that advice, you will see how dangerous it is. It will lead you into mental illness. Because if you were to sit down and write all the good things your parents did to you, you will not be able to do it. All the kindness, 60 times a day they had to stand up. As I said, they had to wake up. 60 times a day they had to respond to your crying. If you were to list every good deed that your parents did to you and compare it with these isolated events that you have misconstrued or imagined against your parents and try to put it to blame, we pick up one thing and forget the billions and billions of acts of kindness and dedication and sacrifice that the parents did for you. So he's saying that, look, you cannot survive. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying that if a person thinks that they can get away with this, then know that ridha Rabbi fi ridha al-walid. That the pleasure of Allah is linked to the pleasure of the parent, al-walid. Al-walid here means parent, because al-walid, al-abbu walid wal-ummu walid, wa huma walidan. That they're both parent. A mother is walid and a father is walid. Both are walid here in this, because they're abawan. وَسَخَطُ الرَّبِّ فِي سَخَطِ الْوَالِدِ. And the displeasure of Allah lies in the displeasure of your parents. If Allah is displeased with you and the entire planet, the 7 billion human beings think that you are the best, they think that you are the best human being, but Allah is angry with you, can you be successful in this world and in the next? What does Allah say to us? Is that this being disobedient to parents, being horrible to your parents, being harsh in your speech to your parents, will result in Allah causing the punishment to begin in this world, not for the next, in this world. He starts it here. He said, "Illa uququl walidain," that all the others he may leave until you reach there, but the ones when it comes to parents, it brings it forward. And this is why he taught the Sahaba. In their experience, they had to. He made them realize the importance of it by the commands, the instructions, the discussions he's had. And here is a discussion. A man travels from Sana'a in Yemen all the way to Medina. You're talking about 700 miles. And he comes, and to show his dedication to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to show that how he's coming to meet the Prophet and he's coming to dedicate his life to the Prophet, and to show how keen he was, he says to him, "Jituka أُبَايِعُكَ عَلَى الْهِجْرَةِ وَتَرَكْتُ أَبَوَيَّ يَبْكِيَانِ." He said, I come to pledge allegiance to you, and in order to emphasize his sacrifice and to show how big a sacrifice it is that he has traveled so far and come, he said, I even left my two parents crying. Now, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not a cult leader like the cult leaders we have today. That his ego did not get big in hearing this, that look, personally leave their parents and come to support me. If he was a cult leader, then yes, his ego would have grown. But Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not looking to increase his fellowship and his followers at the expense of the rules of Allah. So what did he say to that man? This is a man who has traveled 700 miles and come, and he says to him, "Irji' alayhima." فَأَضْحِكْهُمَا كَمَا أَبْكَيْتَهُمَا. He said, return to your parents. What did you just say? You've left them crying? Return to your parents and make them laugh as you have made them cry. أَضْحِكْهُمَا كَمَا أَبْكَيْتَهُمَا. This is the teaching of Islam. Is that the tables have to be turned around. You have to show kindness. You have to show that when you are articulate and eloquent and they are stammering and incoherent, the tables of kindness has to be turned around. And know, as I said last week, that we cannot imagine, we cannot fully grasp the sacrifices that the parents made. And there are several stories about people carrying their mothers on the back all across Hajj, from Khurasan, from Yemen, and from different places. And the response when they asked, have I fulfilled the right of my mother who carried me? They carried their mother on their backs for a whole year in Hajj, to and fro and throughout Hajj. And when they asked the Sahaba, they asked Umar radiallahu anhu and others about whether they have fulfilled the right, what are they told? They say, no, you have not even fulfilled wala talqatan wahida. You have not even fulfilled the right of the first scream she gave when giving birth to you. Not even one scream. Wala bizafratin min zafaratiha. Not even one that she has made, you have not fulfilled it. After having carried your mother for a whole year on your back. If that is the case, then what about us today? Our parents, are literally afraid to speak to their children today. And this is because of this culture of blame, this culture of disconnect, and not seeing that Allah has placed your success, your closeness to Him with the parent. A man came to Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, and said that, look, I've committed a grave sin, I think murder, so some severe sin, and I want to, is halim in tawbatin, can I be forgiven? And Abdullah ibn Abbas said to him, Ummuka hayyatun? He said, is your mother alive? And he said, no. And then he said to him, well, tub ila Allah, may repent to Allah, and then taqarrab ilayhi bimastata'at. Then try to get close to Allah's mercy with whatever you can. So when that man walked away, Ammar ibn Yasir, another Sahaba, was sitting there, and he saw this conversation, and he went up to him and he said, and remember, this is Abdullah ibn Abbas. These are the people who truly understood Allah's deen, who truly understood what Allah expected from us and the closeness and the relationships between these dynamics, these family dynamics. So he said, why did you ask him if his mother is still alive? This is a man who wants to be forgiven for a grave sin, and he's asking me, is your mother alive? And then what did he say? He said that the reason I asked him why if his mother is alive, because I do not know of any other action that will take you to the mercy, closest, so close to the mercy of Allah, than birril walida, than the kindness to a mother. I do not know any other action. That is the relationship. That's the level that if you want forgiveness, if you want good in this world, you want good in the next, then treat your parents with respect, with kindness. And as I said throughout the series, it is about controlling the tone of your voice in the first instance. The primary thing is to control the way you speak, because the way you speak will have your parents' heart is completely open. It's completely defenseless against your words, what you say, because it has spent years tuned to your voice to hear every coup you made in order to see you. Your mother, when you were a baby, from the time you were born, every sound that came out of your mouth was an alarm for her mind to respond to. She has listened to everything that has come out of your mouth to be able to respond, to take care of you. So we are told, be careful how you speak. Her heart is more vulnerable to your voice than the voice of anyone else. So this is why when a Sahaba came to Abdullah ibn Umar and he said that I think I've committed grave sin. What should I do? And he said that what you did was not grave sin, but if you avoid the great sin, he told him the list of the great sins. And he said to him that, do you want atafruqun nar? He said that atafruqun nar wa tuhibbu an tadkhulul jannah, that you do want to be protected from the fire, and do you want to enter jannah? And he said, of course, wallahi, yes, wallahi, of course. And then he asked him, he said, ahayyun walidak, are your parents alive? And he said, qultu indi ummi. He said, I have my mother is still alive. And then he said to him, fa wallahi law alanta laha al-kalam wa at'amta laha al-ta'am latadkhulun al-jannata majtanabta al-kaba'ir. That if you make soft your voice towards her, make soft your voice towards her and feed her, and you avoid the grave sins, then you will enter into Jannah. This is the formula that they were giving. أَلَنْتَ لَهَا الْكَلَامِ, controlling of that. So we are to recognize that birr, that this is the thing that will lead to so. This is your first hurdle of righteousness. If you fail on this, then you will fail on the others. I also said to you last week about the behavior of Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha, that what she used to do. When the entrance of, imagine when you were a baby and your parents were in a room and you as a baby crawled into the room. What was the reception? They were all gentle and nice and welcoming to you when you came into the room, when you were a child. They all tried to make you happy when you came into the room. Today, when our parents come into the room and we are locked, we are distracted on the screens of our devices, what do we do? Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anhu would stand up and hold her father's hand, kiss his head, and let him sit where she was sitting. That's the welcome that a Muslim child should have for his parent. Kissing the parent. When last have you kissed your parent? When last? And this is not only for the young children. This is for the adults as well. This is for the adults. Yes. Abdullah ibn Abbas, here again in the hadith marfu, He says, "Man qabbala bayna 'aynay ummihi kana lahu sitran min an-nar." That whoever kisses his mother between the eyes and the forehead, that will become a veil for him from the fire of hell. If you kiss your mother. Today, I want us all to go home. And if you have your mother, if your mother is still alive, then kiss her with this hadith in mind. That he's saying that it will become. Kiss her today and every day. Let her plan. Then you will see Allah's pleasure. I don't have my mother to do this. You, many of you have your mother. Imagine if your mother were to die in 2 days. How many times would you kiss her? How many times would you show kindness to her? You have no knowledge of when she will die. We do not know when our parents will die. So make use of the opportunity. Like that Sahaba who said when his mother died, that they asked him, why was that this tabi'i? He said, well, why are you crying? He said, I had 2 doors of Jannah open to me, and today one of my doors have closed. So why should I not cry? Your parents are doors to Jannah. So make use of the opportunity you have in every day, showing kindness to them, and not be sucked in to this blame parents culture in which we live. Because this is a plan of shaitan. It is a strategy of shaitan to destroy the heart of your parent and also to destroy your life. May Allah protect us all and guide us to true birr al-walidain, to true kindness to our parents, so that we can earn the mercy of Allah. Wa jazakum Allahu khair. Wassalamu alaykum.
Tabarakallahu rabbul alamin.